All right. Now, are you ready for the lecture? At the end of the previous lecture, I talked about cross sections and decay bits a little bit. Right now, we will apply that knowledge to the Higgs boson. So we will look at the decays of the Higgs. Obviously, this is important because we want to find the Higgs. So we want to know what the Higgs decays into. Here is Higgs, and here is the Higgs boson. Maybe it won't look exactly like this, we don't know. But the LHC will tell. Now, the Higgs Lagrangian takes the following form. Of course, you have to replace this del mu by the covariant derivative. And from the covariant derivative terms, you can obtain interaction terms between the Higgs field and the gauge bosons that was numbered. By the way, I will put the Holmgren solutions. I will photocopy the Holmgren solutions after the lecture, so you can check.
Will they be also in the internet, in the IndyCos page?
Will they be where?
Also in the on the internet?
I'm not sure. Okay. But I mean it will be on the entrance floor. Right? Now. Here, if you just look at the terms involving the Higgs, then you don't have to take covariant derivative. You just look at the potential terms. And these terms will give you the Higgs potential and also the self-interaction terms. Right? Just instead of the Higgs field expanded around its vacuum expectation value, the excitations around the vacuum correspond to the physical Higgs particle, the Higgs boson. So just replace this Higgs field by this expansion and you will obtain the mass and you will obtain the interaction terms. For example, here I have replaced these pi's and pi values by this expression. So I obtain this potential. Remember, mu square is negative. Lambda, of course, is positive to keep the potential stable. And if you look at the mass terms, the mass term, remember, for a scalar field is 1/2 times mass square times field square. So we will just take the terms which are quadratic in the Higgs field. From the first term, we have 1/2. Mu square. And from the second term, just remember binomial expansion, this is v to the 4 plus 4 times v h cube plus 6 times v square h square. That's the term we want, h square. So we have 6 v square over 4. I took a 1/2 out, so that's 6 over 2. Lambda v square. Right, so this is mass of the Higgs, mh square. Now, the Higgs wave is given by this expression, minus mu square over lambda. So, instead of lambda v square, I can put minus mu square. Then I get mh is equal to minus 2 mu square. Remember again, mu square is negative, alright? So this has correct sign. And if you write it in terms of lambda, just replace mu square by v times v square times lambda. With a minus sign. So you get, if I did the math correctly, I'm not sure. dilute volume. Minus 1 plus 3, yes, is 2. So you get square root of 2 times lambda times v. That's the Higgs mass. Now the Higgs vacuum expectation value you know, because it's related to Higgs it's related to the W boson mass. The W boson mass is G2V over 2. And so from here, or from the Fermi coupling, whatever, doesn't matter, you can calculate the Higgs vacuum expectation value to be 246 GeV. However, you don't know mu square and you don't know lambda. You only know the ratio. Therefore, the Higgs mass is unfortunately unknown. It depends on this unknown coupling. But you see, Higgs wave is 246 GeV, so the unknown coupling, well, okay, I'll come to that. The unknown coupling is unknown. But there are bounds on it. There are both experimental bounds and theoretical bounds.
Sorry. So is lambda constant or
it's
something?
No, it's just a coupling constant.
So it will be
it is constant but it runs with energy, just like other gauge couplings.
Okay.
It's like a gauge coupling.
Okay.
It gives you the self interaction term. So it gives you lambda 5 to the 4, you know what it is, right? You have self-interaction. Vertex factor is lambda, and you have 4 Higgs fields. That's what this term is. Now, here are the bounds on the Higgs mass. First of all, as you know, before AHC, before the Large Hadron Collider, in that tunnel, there was the Large Electron-Positron Collider, LEP. And the LEP collaboration collided electrons and positrons, out of them, collected a lot of data, and put this bound on the Higgs mass, excluded this entire yellow region. So LEP excludes a Higgs mass which is less than 114 GeV. Here I'm talking about the standard model Higgs and the standard model only, so no new physics. If you just have standard model, then Higgs mass of less than 114 GeV is excluded. Right? Now, the Tevatron, which is still taking data, excluded this small range, which is roughly 162, between 162 and 166. This may have changed a little bit, I don't know, but just very small range. This range corresponds to roughly twice the W boson mass. That's easy to understand because if Higgs is heavy enough, as we will see, it predominantly decays into W plus W minus. And W's also decay. You end up with four fermions, which is relatively easy to detect. So that's why the collider, the hadron colliders, first put a constraint on around this range, and that's where the LHC will first probe also. So if the Higgs mass is something like 170 GeV, LHC will find it very quickly, if it's a standard model is. If it's lighter, then as we'll see, it becomes a little bit more difficult. Now, there is also electronic precision data, which prefers a light Higgs. Now, the meaning of this electronic precision data is this. You haven't observed the Higgs, but there are a lot of other processes that you have observed. And the Higgs affects those processes through loops, through radiative corrections. Therefore, if you observe those processes very precisely, then you put a constraint on Higgs. And people made a lot of observations of electronic processes. When they combine all their data, they prefer Higgs actually 90 to 100 GeV, right? But that's already excluded. So you combine the LEP limit with the electronic precision data, and data electronic precision data still doesn't put a very good constraint on Higgs mass, because the corrections of the Higgs mass is logarithmic. So you get this band, and roughly at 95% confidence level, electronic precision data says that standard model Higgs must be lighter than 200 GeV. Now, I should make a clarification here. These bounds, they are only for standard model Higgs. So, if you have an extended Higgs sector, the bounds will be, of course, different. Also, if you have just a standard model Higgs, but you have other particles, the bounds can be different. The reason is, for example, let's say you have a light hidden particle, like pseudoscalar, let's say, which has feeble interactions with other particles, so you don't see it. But Higgs decays into those particles instead of decaying into BB bar or tau tau. Right? Then you miss the Higgs. And then you can, the left bound is no longer true. So when you search for the Higgs, you should keep an open mind. Right? Even though you have this bound, it's only for, you know, it's only valid if you have standard model only and no new physics. For example, you could have some new physics that also affect electronic precision data, and although the Higgs is heavier than 200 GeV, other new physics cancel the effect of the Higgs, so electronic precision data is still okay. Right? So now, there are, however, also theoretical constraints on the standard model Higgs, which are roughly consistent with the experimental constraints. Experimental constraints and theoretical constraints, they are equally strong. That's what I mean. Right. So theoretical constraints also say that Higgs mass should be lighter than a few hundred GeV in the standard model. One theoretical constraint comes from the quantum corrections, loop corrections to lambda. This coupling lambda, you don't want it to blow up, or you don't want it to become zero. Otherwise, the theory will not make sense. So, from those constraints, you get something like 600 GeV. Right? And there's also a unitarity bound, which I will talk more about, it's important. It looks weaker, but it's important. You'll see why. Yeah.
Can we use that unitarity upper bound for other particles, or it's only for Higgs?
This unitarity bound, I will talk about it in a few slides, but it has to do with... I will talk about it in a few slides. Please, if it doesn't answer your question, ask again. It's for Higgs or whatever replaces Higgs. Okay, I will come to it. Any questions so far? Yeah.
How does the experiments bound the mass of the Higgs?
You calculate the decay modes of the Higgs. Mm-hmm. It's a function of Higgs mass, which I will show in a couple slides. Right? Then you look at the final results. So, you know, if Higgs is decaying to tau plus, tau minus, you know the kinematics. You search for an event that has the signatures of Higgs decaying to tau plus, tau minus, for example.
So if you don't find, there will be bound.
Yeah, if you don't see the Higgs, you put a bound, like large, like lab collaborations did. I mean, you know the cross-section. If it's standard model Higgs, you know the cross-section. You collect some data, some inverse picobars, femtobars. You multiply by cross-section, you have an expected number of events. If the events are not there, you put a bound. I don't know, I mean, I'm probably oversimplifying, but it's something like that.
And we expect, if there is only standard model Higgs, we expect to have 100 GeV. We expect his Higgs mass to have 100 GeV.
We expect the Higgs mass in the standard model to be between 114 and 200, roughly. Okay, but that's just, you know, that's an interesting region to search. But you should look at the entire range. Alright, now let's see what the Higgs decays into. The Higgs couplings, I have talked about this. This was homework. Now, the Higgs coupling is can be written as the Higgs vacuum expectation value. This combination G2 over 2 MW is just vacuum expectation value times the fermion mass. Because it's the vacuum expectation value that gives the fermion its mass. So we have seen this. Therefore, the Higgs couples to heavier fermions more strongly. And there is also the Higgs WW coupling, which I will come to in next slide. Now let's just look at this process. We want to estimate the decay rate. Alright, so the matrix element has this vertex factor, GF. It has two external spinners, which are approximately masses. Higgs can decay into everything but the top. So the bottom has mass, the bottom part has mass much smaller than the Higgs mass. So I can neglect it for an approximate calculation. Then, these two spinners will give me an energy factor, and the relevant energy is Higgs mass. Right? So, the matrix element becomes GF times Higgs mass. Then you square it, you have GF square times Higgs mass square. The 4 here comes from value sum over you sum over spins of final fermions, that gives you a factor 4. 2 for each. Then you just replace, you just insert GF square, you have an MH square. Then in the expression for decay rate, you have a Higgs mass square here. You have final momentum, but for massless particles, final momentum is just Higgs mass over 2. Right? So when you put that all in, you are left with one factor of Higgs mass here. Then you have the mass of the fermion square. Right? That was just estimate. If you do the actual calculation, you get one half of this for a lepton, and for a quark, you have color factor 3, so you multiply by 3. Any questions? Okay, so you can see also from this expression that Higgs will decay predominantly to bottom quark, BB bar, among the fermions. Now, let's consider the decays to W bosons. These decays will be important if the Higgs is heavy. If the Higgs is much lighter than 2 MW, the decays will be kinematically suppressed. Now, to illustrate a point that I will use later, I'm assuming Higgs mass to be much larger than 2 MW. And this is actually not preferred by electrophilic precision data, but for simplicity I will assume it. Right? And also it will be important to discuss unitarity bound later on. So just assume. Then the naive estimate for the decay rate, if you just, you know, somebody says, tell the quick what's the decay rate, you would say, okay, it has to be MH, because MH is much larger than MW, so it's the only relevant mass is MH. Okay, but unfortunately, you would be wrong. And the reason why you would be wrong has to do with spontaneous symmetry breaking. The W gauge boson obtains mass through the Higgs mechanism. And when it obtains mass, it acquires a long chosen polarization mode. So you have to pay attention to that longitudinal polarization mode because it's special. The main contribution to the cross section comes from that mode, so I will consider only that polarization mode. Now, if you write a matrix element, you have a vertex vector G2MW. Just remember G2MW, right? And then you have polarization vectors of the outgoing W bosons, epsilon, epsilon prime. If the polarization mode is longitudinal, you can write the polarization vector in the rest frame as simply 0, 0, 0, 1. I'm taking the longitudinal mode to be in the z direction. Then to get the general result, you boost it. Remember Lorentz transformation from the first lecture. You have this polarization mode, 0, 0, 0, 1. You apply Lorentz transformation in the z direction. Gamma, gamma, beta, gamma, beta, gamma. Zeros everywhere else. And when you multiply, you get gamma beta from the first row, you get gamma from the last row. And so gamma beta gamma. Where energy is gamma times m, and therefore gamma is energy over mass. Energy over mass. Beta is 1 because we are assuming Higgs mass is much larger than Mw, so Mw's, the decaying W bosons are relativistic. They have speed equal to speed of light, approximately. So beta is 1. Therefore, gamma beta is also P0 over Mw. So you can write the polarization vector as P0 over Mw times 1, 0, 0, 1. But this is just the same thing as energy momentum vector for vector over Mw. For a massless particle, energy momentum vector looks like this. So, I can replace this combination of polarization vectors for the longitudinal mode with the following expression. We have an energy momentum vector coming from one W boson, another from the other W boson, and for each we have a factor Mw, so we have Mw squared. Right? Now, from simple kinematics, ma square is p plus p prime square. Each p square gives you an mw square, and there's a cross term. So you calculate p dot p prime, where these are four vectors again, as ma square over 2. So then this means the matrix element has ma square from here. And it has an over 1 over Mw, because you have Mw here. Right? When you square it, you get mh to the 4 over Mw square. And finally, if you use the expression for the decay rate, you have an mh square here, you have an mh over 2 here, you multiply by 4 pi for solid angle, and at the end, you end up with mh cube over Mw square. And since mh is much larger than mw, this decay rate is much larger than the naive estimate. It goes like cube of mh. I mean, I wanted to show this in little bit detail because when I talk about unitarity bound, I will use this result. So, now if you, this was of course simplified calculation. If you include all the kinematic factors and do the calculations, you can calculate all the decay modes of the Higgs. And if you make a plot, it looks like this. When the Higgs is larger than 140 GeV, the main decay mode is WW. There is also ZZ. Okay. So the main decay mode is to gauge bosons. In that case, remember, it's relatively easy to find Higgs in hadron colliders. But when the Higgs is lighter than 140 GeV, the main mode becomes BB bar, and BB bar is hard because the hadron colliders are full of B jets, lots of background. I don't know even if it's possible to use BB bar mode or not. I mean, it's difficult if not impossible. Your experimental colleagues will tell you more about this. And this, I don't really know. I just know it's difficult. Yeah.
Can I ask, what exactly is the
WW that
came out with respect to physics?
Oh, it's just a factor of two. When the Higgs mass is large, here it drops due to kinematics because Z boson mass is heavier. And when the Higgs mass is large, there is a factor of two. And,
what does this factor tell?
What? Yeah, I mean, you see, I haven't done actual calculation. I have just estimated it. I mean, you have to insert the gamma matrices, polarization vectors, take the trace, and calculate. I don't have obvious answer. It has to do probably with W's being charged and Z being neutral, but I don't know. I mean, you should look at the calculation and see where the difference comes.
Can you ask something?
Yeah.
So when Higgs is decaying to 2W, shouldn't the mass higher than 160 GeV? Before W doesn't have any mass, before the decay, I mean, it's confused.
Okay. The decay, Higgs can still... You have a resonance, all right? You produce the Higgs and it decays. I mean, you have. Processes AB going to some resonance, going to CD. Suppose resonance is Higgs, C plus D is the two W bosons. If C plus D is heavier than R, mass of R, the decay is still possible. It's just kinematically suppressed. It's suppressed by propagator factors. But it doesn't just cut off like this. It's cut off gradually.
But still, if I take the center of mass frame of A plus B collision,
so does this plot also prove the case for, let's say, the one Z is constant, the other constant, so this would extend this?
Can you repeat?
So this plot, let's say, is the width for ZZ came on, right? But does this also...
No, this is just branching ratios. This doesn't show your cross section. What?
Let's take this one, which has a branching function.
Okay.
So this branching function for ZZ that is given this plot,
yeah,
also includes the case for one Z is offset, right?
Yes.
So does this could explain why it's not the cutoff is not still possible?
You see, to the question was to James' question, there was somebody who replied saying that the boson is not on the mass share. It's virtual. So that was the entire argument. So the correct terminology in the indicator should be maybe WW star, comma ZZ star. Star meaning it's a virtual particle. And that allows you to go up to 140.
Yeah, I mean, the thing is, the Zs will decay to fermions. And once you see the end result, once you see the fermions, then you include both the on-shell and off-shell contributions. Off-shell contribution will be smaller. So, I want you to pay attention to the parts where Higgs mass is light, between 140 and 100. Right? In this part, BB bar is the main decay mode, but it's hard to see. So you go down for hadron colliders, you go down to this decay mode, gamma-gamma, which is very clean. But it has cross-section of order, it has a branching ratio of order 10 to the minus 3. So you have to collect much more data to use this mode. Right? Since the cross-section is small, you have to collect much more events so that you have some events that include Higgs to gamma-gamma. So that's why light Higgs will be harder to discover if there's a standard model Higgs. And roughly, if the center of mass energy is 14 TeV, you need 10 inverse femtowatts. If center of mass is smaller, you need more. For 7, you would multiply this by 3 roughly. Okay. So, as you might have heard, LHC will run until end of 2012. Then there will be a shutdown to increase center of mass energy, and it will restart in 2014. Now, if the Higgs is heavy, standard model Higgs is in 160 kind of region, then it could be found even before the shutdown. But if it's light, probably you will have to wait for the end of 2014 to, for a detection. And of course, once you detect something, you have to make sure it's the Higgs. And to make sure it's the Higgs, you have to look at the couplings. That needs more data, so you have to be patient. But if there's a standard model Higgs, then LHC, we will know in a few years. So you are lucky, we are lucky being young people. People were waiting 30 years for this, you know, superconducting, supercollider got cancelled, so on. But we are in a good time to be particle physicists. Alright, now, how about the unitarity bond? Unitarity bond has to do with maximum possible cross-section. Right. Now, if you have a resonant process, there is a peak in the cross-section. This is the Bright-Wigner form. This width is the decay width. Right. This is the resonant energy. And the expression near the resonance for cross-section has this term. Now, if you put energy equal to resonant energy, this term becomes 1. So, the maximum cross-section is that given by this expression here, where L is the spin of the resonance. Kappa is just magnitude of momentum. It's just shown here with kappa. So, that's from scattering, non-relativistic quantum mechanics scattering theory. You make partial wave expansion and so on. Now, if you calculate a cross section larger than this bound, it means that probability is not conserved. So that's why this is called unitarity bound, because you know time evolution of the wave function is unitary, which means probability is conserved. And so if you violate this bound, you are violating unitarity. So that just makes the theory doesn't make sense. That just means, yeah. Alright, for example, consider Fermi theory, which is the effective theory of weak interactions at low energies. You just think of this four Fermi interaction. I mean, now we know that there's a W boson in the propagator, but at low energies, you can approximately write the Lagrangian in this form. And you have an effective coupling, G Fermi. Now, we have looked at muon decay, we calculated the decay bit there, but cross-section is the same thing. You do dimensional analysis. The vertex vector has a G Fermi. You square it, because you are squaring matrix element. and then to get the dimensions right, you should multiply by some of mass energy, which tells you that unitarity will be violated at some point because scattering cross-section increases with center of mass energy. So if you collide very energetic neutrinos and electrons, then the cross-section will be calculated to be larger than the unitarity bound. Which means the theory is not valid at that energy scale anymore. Right? So let's calculate what unitarity bound is numerically for Fermi theory. Now the unitarity bound has this momentum. If you know these are approximately massless, so the momentum is square root of s over 2. Therefore, unitarity bound gives you 16 pi over s. Here I'm considering s wave. Angular momentum is 0, so I put 0 here. Okay, and I divide by 4 because you see there is 4 different helicity combinations, but the charge current only includes one of them, left left going to left left. Right? It's not so important, but anyway, then you compare the cross section that you calculated with the unitarity bound, and you calculate what the center of mass energy, you calculate at which center of mass energy unitarity is violated. And the answer is 700 GeV. Which means when each particle has 350 GeV, unitarity will be violated. Which is of course fine, because Fermi theory is valid at scales less than the W boson mass anyway. Alright, so you don't expect Fermi theory to make sense at this scale. But it's just an example. Now, you solve this unitarity problem, this particular unitarity problem, by adding the W boson. Adding the W boson cures unitarity problem for this process. However, it doesn't cure unitarity problem in standard model by itself, if you just add W boson. Okay? It turns out unitarity is still violated in WW scattering, unless there is a Higgs, standard model Higgs, with mass smaller than TeV. And now the importance of this is that you know that WW scattering violates unitarity at 1 TeV. But it could be that there is no Higgs particle, but you know there is some other alternative mechanism. Whatever the alternative mechanism is, it should act below a TeV. Or it should affect WW scattering below a TeV. This you know from unitarity bound. And that's why people say there must be new physics, or either Higgs mechanism or other new physics at the TeV scale. And you cannot just have standard model without the Higgs, or without emptiness. I hope that's clear. Because you know this is how you know people could obtain the funding for LSC. Right? If we couldn't argue that we have to see something at the TV, it would be very difficult to get the money. All right, now consider the process WW going to ZZ through a Higgs resonance. To make the calculation, we will use the results that I showed a couple slides ago, just for the longitudinal modes. You had the vertex vector, then you have the Higgs propagator, ma squared minus s, and you have the polarization vectors for the W's and the Z's. And we saw a couple of slides ago that polarization vectors you can write as p dot p prime over m w square, and same for z. Here I'm just making rough estimates, so m z m w I don't care. It's just mass of the weak gauge boson. Now, we are looking at high energy scattering. So the external particles are relativistic. Therefore, these momentum factors just give you center of, just give you S over 2. And then you have a matrix element which has the form S squared over MA squared minus S. This means if S is large enough so that, you know, MA squared is negligible, matrix element scales with S. You take the square, it scales with S squared. Then to calculate cross-section, you divide by S, but the cross-section still grows with S. When the cross-section grows with S, that means what unitarity will be violated at some point. And now, I'm kind of explaining it a little bit roundabout way, but what I've shown here is that if you just consider WW ZZ scattering mediated by Higgs, you get a cross-section that grows with S, which is unacceptable. But you have WW going to ZZ by other processes as well. You know, WW can go to ZZ through Gauge boson mediation or just this vertex. Now these processes, you can calculate cross-section, but there will be some, the matrix element will be some function of central mass energy and the Gauge boson mass. Right? Now, at high enough energy, we know that this function must grow with S, because we know that to, you know, for unitarity to be not violated, the terms in the cross-section that grows with S must be cancelled. Right? So if you have a cross-section that grows with S from this process, then you should have a cross-section that grows with S from also this process, so that the terms cancel. I mean, if you do the calculation, it turns out that they cancel. I'm just kind of motivating why this should be so. Right? Now, here's the thing. You have a cross-section here that grows with S, and you have a cross-section here that also grows with S. But if the Higgs mass is heavy, then the cross-section of this process involving the Higgs will be suppressed. You'll be only left with the part that comes from WWZZ, this diagram, and it grows with S, so it will violate unitarity. Okay? So, I cannot go into more detail, but that's my explanation to why. Any questions? Yeah.
I don't understand why did we accept that this process should confirm the unitarity.
Okay.
Didn't you set the premise like, is it not proper for the people?
I made strange kind of argument, I know, but here is my argument again. Now, I calculate cross-section for this process, and I get a result that's at, you know, when the center of mass energy is high enough, I get a result that grows with S, grows with cross-section. Okay. Then I say, we should consider other processes as well. And you consider this process, you calculate cross-section. It also grows with S. I haven't shown you the calculation, but if you do it, it also grows with S. And the part that grows with S cancels the part that grows with S coming from the Higgs. That's how unitarity is restored. Right? Now imagine that the Higgs mass is heavy. If you take Higgs mass to infinity, then this first term disappears. But the second term is still there, and the second term grows with S. So you know that unitarity will be violated if the Higgs mass is still there, but it is too heavy. That's why the Higgs mass must be lighter than TeV to keep unitarity, respect unitarity bound. Maybe still clear.
So, the term
unitarity
is first diagram and that
No, no, no. I mean, if you write, if you add up all the amplitudes, take the absolute value and square it, right? And take central mass energy to high values, so that all the masses become negligible. Then the terms that are proportional to S cancel. Maybe we are saying the same thing. Did that answer your question or not? They are different, but the pieces that are proportional to S cancel.
For all mass, or for some mass.
They cancel in the limit where S is much larger than Higgs mass square. For all masses that are light enough. Okay. All right. So, now I want to move on. So far, I haven't talked about the quark mixing. So far, if you look at the standard model Lagrangian, there is no diagram for B and S quarks to decay. So they should be stable. But you know that they are not. And the reason is quark mixing. So now I'll try to explain what quark mixing is about. Now, you have this Yukawa couplings that gives mass to quarks, right? Just like leptons. Up to now, I have written this expression for Yukawa couplings for a single family. For a single family, this is just a number, a coupling. Right? But actually, we have three families here. Right? So for three families, you have, you know, three quarks, then three anti-quarks, then you have the Higgs wave, and then you have the Yukawa coupling matrix. Right? It's a 3x3 matrix. One for up-type quarks, one for down-type quarks. It's a 3x3 complex unitary matrix. Is it unitary? No, man. Just a 3x3 complex matrix in general. Alright? And there is no reason why this matrix should be diagonal. So when you have a situation like this where there are non-diagonal terms in the Lagrangian, what you do is you do a similarity transformation. You diagonalize the mass matrix so that you find the mass eigenstates. Right? The physical particles are the mass eigenstates. Now, doing a similarity transformation means you rotate the quarks. You apply a unitary matrix on the quarks. Right? But when you rotate the quarks, you have these charge current interactions. Right? These become non-diagonal. So, in other words, mass eigenstates do not coincide with weak interaction eigenstates. Therefore, when you write weak interaction eigenstate as linear superposition of mass eigenstates, you will be connecting quarks of different generations in charge current interactions. That's called quark mixing. Now, let's see a little bit more detail. In general, of course, we have three families, but first I will talk about two families only. For two families only, here is the charged current interaction written in terms of weak interaction eigenstates. So in terms of weak interaction eigenstates, you have up and down quark and strange and charmed quark connected with W plus and W minus. Now, I write I replace this weak interaction eigenstates with D prime and S prime to distinguish them from mass eigenstates. And I write the weak interaction eigenstates as a unitary matrix times the mass eigenstates. I use this unitary matrix to diagonalize the Yukawa couplings. Alright. So this just means that you have a 2x2 unitary matrix with determinant 1, just a general matrix. You multiply down quark and strange quark with this matrix. I will talk about why we do it to down type quarks rather than up type quarks. It's just a convention, but I'll come back to it. So you multiply DNS quarks, you get a term like this and a term like this. There are some angles and there are some phases. Alright, but well, what you do is you can multiply the quarks. You can redefine a quark field by multiplying it with a global phase. So for a left-handed quark, you redefine it by multiplying with some phase, let's say. And you do it the same for the right-handed part. And you can check that the standard model will remain invariant. Alright, so by this trick, you can get rid of these phases here. Right? You have an e to the I alpha here, but you just redefine the d prime quark as e to the minus I alpha times d prime. It's just like rotating the wave function. It doesn't affect anything if it's a global phase. You do the same for the strange quark and so on, and you get rid of all these phases. So you are left with a rotation matrix. The weak interaction eigenstates are given in terms of the mass interaction eigenstates as follows. And you just have a mixing angle. The mixing angle is called Kabibwa angle. Experiments tell us that its value is roughly 13 degrees. Now let's see what all this means in a little bit more practical fashion. Now if you write if you just expand, or just write cosine theta, sine theta, etc. here, write all the terms. The diagonal terms in this matrix will give you couplings between the same generation, right, up and down, strange and charm. So couplings between the same generation is multiplied with cosine theta. And then you have these off-diagonal couplings, which make the strange quark and the bottom quark decay. So this coupling, for example, makes the strange quark decay into up quark through this process. And the vertex factor includes a sine theta here. The vertex factor for the same generation processes include a cosine theta. Any questions? Note again, this is the only place in the standard model where you have a particle from a generation going to another generation. Now, here we rotated just the down quarks. We could have rotated the up type quarks also, but if you look at the Lagrangian, where you have a rotation matrix rotating down quarks, and you have a rotation matrix rotating the up quarks, both of them are unitary. You multiply them, you still get a unitary matrix. Right, so yeah, putting two separate rotation matrices here doesn't give you anything new. You can just define this whole thing as your quark mixing matrix. Right, so you don't have to rotate up and down type quarks separately. It's enough to rotate either the down quarks or the up quarks. And the convention is to rotate the down quarks. So that's just what people have agreed on.
So what does this V degrad V down do? I understand something.
This matrix is the rotation matrix. Well, okay. You can always. you can always change your basis, make us similarity transformation. And you can either diagonalize the uptype, the Yukawa coupling matrix for uptype quarks, or you can diagonalize the Yukawa coupling matrix for downtype quarks. But you cannot diagonalize both of them with the same transformation at the same time, right?
Yeah.
So you either diagonalize uptype quarks or you diagonalize downtype quarks. The convention is to diagonalize downtype quarks. And so if you used just for being pervert a basis where both the uptype quarks, uptype quark you call coupling, and downtype quark you call coupling is non-diagonal, then these matrices would be the ones that diagonalize each of those. But they just make one matrix at the end. Alright, now it's important to note that this quark fixing phenomenon is only for the charge current in the standard model. The neutral current involves just up-type quarks interacting with up-type quarks and down-type quarks interacting with down-type quarks. So here you rotate with V for down-type quarks, and then you rotate D bar with V dagger. This is a unitary matrix, V times V dagger is 1. Alright, so for neutral current, there is no mixing. This is important. In the standard model, there is no flavor changing neutral currents. Now, in physics, in models beyond the standard model, and also in at the loop level, you can get such processes. So it's an important probe of physics beyond the standard model. This will be discussed in much more detail in flavor physics lectures on Monday and Tuesday by Tobias Hurt. Here's homework for you, but I know you have a lot of homework, so this time I've given you very small homework. Just draw Feynman diagrams, that's it. Should take just a couple minutes. Alright, now let's consider the case of tree families. For tree families, we will get a new feature, as you will see. Now, you have this mixing matrix. It's a 3x3 unitary matrix. It has 9 independent parameters, 3 square. Now, remember that you can rotate the quarks and get rid of some of these phases that are in this unitary matrix. But you have 6 quarks to rotate, and rotating all the quarks together doesn't mean anything. It's just an overall phase. So there is only 5 independent rotations that you can make. That means you can only get rid of 5 parameters from this general unitary matrix. So 4 parameters are left. 3 of these 4 parameters are mixing angles. The fourth one is a phase. So you can use different parametrizations, but one common parametrization for this quark mixing matrix, also called Kabuko, Kobayashi, Maskawa, or CKM matrix, is this. You have 3 mixing angles. C stands for cosine theta 1, 2 here. Right? So you have a mixing angle theta 1, 2, mixing angle theta 1, 3, mixing angle theta 2, 3, and you have a phase. This phase in the CKM matrix turns out to explain all CP violating phenomena observed in the standard model, observed experimentally so far. Right? To see why, I will make a little bit of review. I will review parity, charge, and time reversal. Discrete symmetries, very briefly. Now remember, parity meant inverting the coordinates. Right? And under parity transformation, if the wave function is even or odd, then system will be invariant. And also, as it has been mentioned in previous lectures, particles have intrinsic parities. They are either even or odd. Standard model, Y-based parity. For example, the charge current only only left-handed parts of the Dirac spinners interact with the charge current. If you make parity transformation, left-handed goes to right-handed because the momentum changes sign if you invert the coordinates. And the right-handed parts do not interact with the weak interaction. So parity is violated. Parity symmetry means left and right acts the same way. Now, charge conjugation is also clearly violated in the standard model. For example, if you take a neutrino, nu L, and if you take just the charge conjugate, you get nu bar L. But such an object does not even exist in the standard model.
Sorry,
sorry.
Can you repeat the question?
Oh, it, you've seen this actually. You see 2x2 case, you have this kind of rotation matrix, right? So if you have a process like S quark going to U quark with a W, since this is changing generation, you are looking at an off-diagonal term in the CKM matrix. So the vertex factor includes a sine theta, which is small. Okay? So this process is Kobibo suppressed. It's suppressed by the every charge process will involve an element of the CKM matrix, and it will be suppressed by absolute value square of that element. I will come back to it. But if you apply charge conjugation and parity conjugation together, things look much better. For example, if you take a left-handed neutrino, apply both parity and charge conjugation, you get right-handed anti-neutrino, which does exist and has same properties. So CP looks like a good symmetry for the standard model, and people for a long time did think that it's a good symmetry. So it was big surprise in 1960s when it was found that CP is actually violated. So there is CP is also violated in the standard model, but CP violation is more subtle. It's not like C or P, which is obviously violated. Now, CPT means you take a state, you do time reversal, then parity transformation, then charge conjugation. It gives the anti-state. And it's a theorem in quantum field theory that if you have Lorentz invariance, CPT must be a good symmetry. So taken all together, CPT must be always respected. That means if CP is violated, time reversal should also, symmetry under time reversal should be also violated. Okay? Now remember time reversal transformations from your quantum mechanics courses. It involved a unitary transformation multiplied by complex conjugate. You can understand why complex conjugation is there simply by remembering that the time evolution involves exponential E energy times T. Now you make time reversal, you are changing sign of time. But you want to keep energy positive, so you better take the complex conjugate. Alright? In particular, if you make this time reversal transformation, the Hamiltonian will be multiplied by complex conjugation. So if the Hamiltonian is complex, time reversal can be violated. Okay? And we just saw that in the CKM matrix, which is in the Lagrangian, so it's in the Hamiltonian, you have this complex phase. Right? So that means time reversal can be violated, which means CP can be violated. Now, CP violation was for a long time only observed for camels. Recently, more recently, it has also been observed in many processes involving bee case. But I will stick with the original example. Now you have this neutral camels, which are DS bar and D bar S. Okay. And suppose that CP is a good symmetry, which is true to a very good approximation. So CP violation is a very small effect. Then you can form CP eigenspace. Right? So when you apply CP, K0 goes to K bar 0. So this combination, K0 plus K bar, is CP even. The other combination, K0 minus K bar, is CP odd. If you take K0 to K bar and K bar to K, you get a minus sign. Right? So these are CP eigenstates. Now, these chaos decay into pions. The pions have an odd parity. Okay? So if the angular momentum is zero, then the space part doesn't make contribution. So you can calculate parity by just multiplying the intrinsic parities of the particles, which simply means two pions will be even, three pions will be odd. And if CP is conserved, just take this to be neutral, okay? You could also have pi plus pi minus pi zero, but you know, charge conjugation doesn't affect things. You either have pi zero, or three pi zeros, or pi plus pi minus pi zero. So applying C doesn't change anything. So, if CP is conserved, the even combination must go to even combination. Odd combination must go to odd combination. Now, chaon decaying to three pions is kinematically suppressed because three pions is heavier than two pions. That's why this combination is called K short, S for short. This combination, which has a longer lifetime, is called K long. Right? And if CP is a good symmetry, K short will always decay to two pions, K long will always decay into three pions. However, it was observed that the KR state decays sometime to two pions. So that's CP violation. As I said, it's a subtle effect. Any questions? Well, I mean,
what was the question?
Why choose chaos for the experiment? The reason is this. This chaos state has longer lifetime. Okay? So the CP conserving decay is suppressed. So if there is a CP non-conserving decay, it's easier to see. That's, I think, the reason. Then maybe other experimental reasons, I don't know. Alright. Now, so far, as I've said, all the CP violating processes observed in nature can be explained by the CKM phase. However, actually, we do think that there must be new sources of CP violation. Orhan Hoca mentioned this briefly in his lecture, because the CP violation in the standard model isn't sufficient to explain the matter-antimatter symmetry observed in the universe. So it's believed that new physics will introduce new sources of CP violation. So for this reason, CP violating processes and also these rare decays, flavor violating decays, mu t e gamma and so on, they are important for probing physics beyond the standard model. Again, there will be more of this by Tobias first lectures. Alright, now to kind of summarize, here's the experimental data. the CPM matrix has these elements, and for charge current processes involving different quarks, you can read out the vertex vector by, you know, if you have a, for example, if you have this process B quark going to U quark, you look at VUB, okay, and this 3 times 10 to the minus 3. Then you have to square it, because this is the matrix element, so it's very much CKM suppressed. Okay? This matrix is not symmetric, so if you are considering T going to down quark, it's different from B going to U quark. It's like 0.008. Now, notice that there's a hierarchical pattern here. Right? You have a Kabibo factor, 0.2, then you have Kabibo factor squared here, then you have Kabibo factor cubed here. And we don't know why. It's one of the mysteries of the standard model. Alright, second homework is again very small homework. Right? Just draw the Feynman diagram for the B quark decay. You will see that it exactly looks like muon decay. Alright, so take the decay bit for muon and just write down the decay bit for the B quark. Just think about what is different. Alright, so here are the parameters of the standard model as taken from Wikipedia. Now I will make comments on these parameters one by one. Now first of all, let's start with the Higgs sector. Higgs sector, I mentioned, is most uncertain part. In the standard model, it has these two unknown parameters. You know mu square over lambda, though. So you don't know mu, you don't know lambda. Well, in the standard model, Higgs does solve a lot of problems, but it also brings new puzzles. And one puzzle has to do with quantum corrections. If you have a fundamental scalar particle, it will obtain quantum corrections to its mass, which is quadratically divergent. Which basically means, if your theory is effective up to some cutoff energy scale, you expect the scalar particle to acquire a mass if there is no Dirichlet cancellations. You expect the particle to acquire a mass of order the cutoff scale of the theory. So, if you say that the standard model is valid up to Planck scale, 10 to the 19 GeV, then you expect the Higgs mass to be 10 to the 19 GeV. But we know that it should be something like 100 GeV. So, this is a puzzle called hierarchy puzzle, which is not addressed in the standard model. And there's a lot of new physics scenarios that try to address this puzzle, like supersymmetry, warped extra dimensions, dynamical symmetry breaking models, and so on. Right? So Gökhan will talk about some BSM scenarios in the afternoon. Oh, there is this parameter in the standard model which I haven't discussed. It's called theta parameter. It turns out that you can add this parameter to the QCD Lagrangian. It's consistent with all the with all the symmetries of the standard model. The general rule is if you have a term which is consistent with the symmetries, you should add it to the Lagrangian, because even if you don't add it at the tree level, it will come from loop corrections. So we add this term, and the term is Coulomb field strength times its dual, which is like electric field dot magnetic field. And it's a CP violating term. So it predicts CP violation in strong interactions, which however has not been observed. And from the experimental bound on the neutron electric dipole moment, people have put a bound on the theta parameter, which is of order 10 to the minus 10. So this parameter, which you know, you expect naively at least to be order 1, has to be less than 10 to the minus 10 to agree with the experiment. This has motivated people to find ways to make theta zero naturally, right? And the popular scenario is called is to introduce a global U1 symmetry called Pecheux-Quinn symmetry, and then to spontaneously break it. Now, what happens when you have a global symmetry and you spontaneously break it?
Particle.
You have a massless particle. That massless particle, however, acquires a mass due to non-perturbative effects, which I don't know much about. Maybe it will be discussed next week. It has to do with instantons in QCD. And the QCD vacuum being, you know, having non-trivial topology is complicated. But the end result is that the Goldstone boson, which is massless, becomes a pseudo-Goldstone boson, which has little bit of mass. And the mass is given by lambda QCD square over the spontaneous symmetry breaking scale. This particle is called the axion. It's a pseudo-scalar particle. Its mass is inversely proportional to the breaking scale of the Pecheux-Quinn symmetry. Its couplings is also inversely proportional. So if this scale is large, then it interacts weakly. Right? And experimentally, this scale is constrained to be larger than 10 to the 9 GeV. So that makes the axion very light and very weak interacting. It's a very interesting particle. It's a dark matter candidate. It can form part of dark matter or even all of dark matter, and people are looking for it. But in experiments like CAST.
Is it a hot or cold dark matter candidate?
It's cold. I mean, all phenomenologically viable dark matter candidates are either cold or warm. Hot dark matter is not consistent with structure formation.
Does everybody know what hot and cold dark matter?
Well, when I mean, let's not go into that. Okay, I can explain it very briefly. I have to talk about decoupling. We'll talk about it later, perhaps. Okay, most of the parameters of the standard model has to do with the fermion masses and mixings. So you have all these masses, starting from the electron up to the top quark mass, which are very different, although they all come from Yukawa couplings in standard model. They all come from similar, same coupling. The Yukawa couplings have different values, so you have a mass of order 100 GeV for the top quark, and a mass less than MeV for the electron mass. So they are different by almost 6 orders of magnitude, million times. And, well, it seems like there is also a pattern. Right? Just like the CKM mixing angles, which has a pattern, the masses also seem to have a pattern. For example, when I look here, I see, if you call the ratio of bottom quark mass to strange quark mass lambda, let's say, there's a ratio lambda between bottom and strange, ratio lambda between strange and down. The up-type quarks, they have ratio lambda square. Okay? All these patterns, maybe they are just in my mind, maybe they are excellent, but maybe because people see patterns, you see. They look at some random data and they see patterns. So you have to be careful. But it could be that there is some family symmetry that relates different generations. And the hope is that, you know, if you see new family flavor-violating processes in LST, maybe it will give us some clues to what the family structure of the theory is. Oh, and there are these things which don't exist. Well, neutrinos are masses in the standard model. But experimentally, through neutrino oscillations, we know that neutrinos do have mass. And they have a mass which is like 10 to the minus 11 GeV, a completely different mass scale from the other leptons. And which makes the mystery of fermion masses and mixings even more mysterious. Here is the data on neutrino masses and mixings. Now, if you look at the quark mixings, you see quark mixing angles are small, right? But if you look at the neutrino mixing pattern, this means half muon neutrino, half tau neutrino. So the weak interaction eigenstate mixes 45 degrees with respect to the mass eigenstate. That's maximal mixing. And if you look at this M2, is one-third electron, one-third muon, one-third tau, approximately. This is called tri-bi-maximal pattern. And again, it suggests some kind of symmetry to me. So you have a mixing pattern that's completely different from the quark mixing pattern. You have two mass splittings of order, you know, 10 to of order 0.05 electron volts for the atmospheric splitting, and 10 to the minus 3 electron volts for solar. And there are different models that try to explain neutrino mass. Simplest extension that you can make to standard model that explains the neutrino masses is to add right-handed neutrino. When you add a heavy right-handed neutrino, you get a light left-handed neutrino. This is called seesaw mechanism, which I will not explain in detail, but read about it. Neutrino physics. Anyway. I think. Neutrino mass in the seesaw mechanism is roughly given as V scale squared, electron V scale squared, over neutrino mass, right-handed neutrino mass. Which tells us that if there are three right-handed neutrino mass, at least the heaviest one should be around 10 to the 14 GeV. That's very model dependent, I'm just talking about the simplest scenario. So that introduced new scale. And also, right-handed neutrinos, they introduce new source of CP violation. And maybe the CP violation that we observe in the universe has to do with the CP violation that comes through the decays of right-handed neutrinos. That's called leptogenesis. It's just a scenario that explains the biomasymmetry of the universe. So, alright, finally. Yes, finally, you have these three gauge couplings. Now, they change with energy. And the way they change with energy is interesting. For U1 gauge theory, it in the standard model, it decreases as you go to higher energies. Oh, I'm sorry, it increases as you go to higher energies. Here you have alpha 1, inverse alpha 1. The strong coupling is strong at low energies. It becomes weaker at high energies, so inverse alpha increases. And they kind of unify in the standard model, but not quite. It's just tantalizing. But now if you take the standard model gauge group and supersymmetrize it, that's called the minimal supersymmetric standard model, here is what you see. Right? The three couplings unify at a point at roughly 2 times 10 to 16 GeV, which has motivated a lot of people to build models based on SU5 or SO10 or other symmetries that break down through some Higgs mechanism, different Higgs mechanism, to the standard model. Alright, so. Yeah, sorry. I couldn't manage to. Can you go to the son sayfaya gidebilir miyiz? Gidelim daha, gidelim. All right. That's all. Any questions? Yeah. If you add right-handed neutrinos, it's just like quark mixing.
Yeah.
So just like you have quark mixing in the charge current, you have lepton mixing. So the mixing matrix is just a lepton mixing matrix. It's called PMNS matrix, okay? Pontecarlo and three Japanese guys. I cannot remember. Maki, Nagawaka. Well, actually, if they matched, if the weak interaction, if the Yukawa coupling matrix was diagonal, then you should ask me, why is it diagonal? In general, it's not diagonal. If you just write the most general term compatible with the symmetries of the standard model, the weak interaction eigenstates are different from mass interaction eigenstates. So you don't require an explanation. If they were the same, then we would require an explanation. Why they are the same? There must be some symmetry to make them the same. Other questions? Oh. Yes, go to lunch.